Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of Vancouver Real. I am your co-host today, Mike Zaremba, and joining me, very happy to say so, is my brother Andy.
Yeah, it feels good to be behind the mic and doing a duo podcast again, because we've been doing a lot of solos lately, which is fun. I like the one-on-ones, but I feel like the conversations are more dynamic and flowy when we have a group.
The trialogue.
Yeah, we have the triad as opposed to the dyad.
Exactly. And that's funny. I've been starting to do like little disclaimers at the beginning of my solo ones, just saying, don't worry, Andy and I, we're still cool. We're still brothers. It's all good. But, and this is just showing you all you faithful listeners out there who keep listening and watching the show. We really appreciate you guys. So thank you so much for joining us today and all the past episodes as well. As per usual, we are podcasting here out of Float House at 70 West Cordova Street. That's where we have our street level podcasting studio here in downtown Vancouver, British Columbia. And I want to send out a recognition towards the unceded lands here of Vancouver. Vancouver is a city that is on unceded lands. This has actually been proclaimed by the city of Vancouver of the Coast Salish territories, which makes up the Musqueam, the Tsleil-Waututh, and the Squamish First Nations people here. So we always want to bring that up when we can, because this is unceded land. And although we're Vancouver Real, this is where this whole city resides. So it's worth saying.
Definitely worth saying. It was good to see. I saw Kelly, actually. She posted a Facebook Live video from the march that was on the weekend.
Right.
And I kept seeing Adam in the crowd. It was kind of funny.
Yeah.
I kept seeing his blue hat. But it's good to bring that kind of awareness. And
yeah, that was cool. I was there. Mm-hmm. So this was the Kinder Morgan pipeline protest march. There's a big one on Saturday. And I don't know the exact number of people there, between 4,000 to 6,000 people probably, which was really cool. I was able to go there, did some Facebook Live videos as well, just showing. It was really cool. I got to be there right for the start of the march. So they had like City Hall. They all were around the City Hall with some speakers and stuff. And then the march started, and the leading people were all the First Nation tribes. I think predominantly the Tsleil-Waututh people. And just they had their drums going, they were singing, and it was just a really cool thing to be there right for when they started marching right on that front line. I was able to do that video, and it's on our Facebook page if you want to see it. And it was a very powerful thing. Then I joined the march and was walking right behind them in support.
Very cool.
For what this is.
Well, it's interesting times, especially with the whole Standing Rock thing going on right now and all the activity going on in that world. So maybe we can get into that a little bit
today. Yeah, I'd like to get into that with our guest today. I think he's going to have great input just on, I don't know, you're a very intelligent man, and I enjoy our conversation, so I'll get your feedback into that. So, but we will get into his intro in just a moment. Lastly, we will plug Omega Point YouTube channel. Omid Pakbin is our co-producer of the show. He helps us behind the scenes. His YouTube channel is Omega Point, and so just a shout out to him, and check out his YouTube page for some really cool videos that he creates on that.
Yeah. Connor tagged some posts last night. That was a Jason Silva video, which Omid produced, which was a really cool one. It was a big talk about Terrence McKenna, and it was very fascinating one by Jason Silva.
Yeah.
I already had like 12,000 shares or something ridiculous that.
Yeah.
But also, you know, if you guys like what you hear today, you know, help us out. Go give us a rating and review on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube. Give us a like on Facebook. All that stuff really helps us get found, because in the social media world and podcasting world, there are thousands and thousands of podcasts these days. So if you can help us get found, we really appreciate that.
Cool. And if you use the promo, I forgot to say this, but if you use the promo code float, sorry, recovery, you can save 20% off a single float at Float House via floathouse.ca. So let's move on to today's episode with a returning guest. Very happy to have you back with us here in the Vancouver Real Studios. And who am I talking about? I'm talking about James W. Jesso, a Canadian author. And well, you do a lot of different things. This is why I always like to pull up your bio here. But basically, you are the author of 3 books, Decomposing the Shadow, Lessons from the Psilocybin Mushroom, that was in 2013, Soundscapes and Psychedelics in 2014, and then the True Light of Darkness in 2015. And I think you published that one just before you came on our show for the first time.
Yep.
And you also are a podcaster as well. You have a podcast called, how do you pronounce it? At Mind?
At Mind Radio, yeah. Well, it was supposed to be Adventures Through the Mind, which was the name of my website.
Okay.
And somehow I'm kind of like stumbling through this whole career, like social media, public figure career haphazardly and picking up broken pieces as I walk along, try to hack my way out and find trails in the path. But yeah, so I called it At Mind Radio, which is short for Adventures Through the Mind, but it's also this totally random out of nowhere word that most people wouldn't even think about. So it wasn't really the best for sort of like branding, but yeah, whatever.
Yeah. Well, it's a great show though. I was on it and as a guest and I really appreciate that. And
yeah.
So it's all through your website, jameswjesso.com, all the links are there to the books, to the podcast, and you can read more about what James does. And I mean, that's the thing, like you mentioned kind of your career that you're in the midst of, you know, you travel when as much as you can, it seems like. You're very adventurous. You write about it. You blog. You share this with your community. And you have these podcasts. And you're, you know, then you put together more formal works of authorship. You do several presentations all the time. Your most recent one was just the last month or so at the Psychedelic Psychotherapy Conference in Victoria. Is that correct?
Yeah.
And what were you talking about there?
I was talking about potential mechanisms behind the treatment of chronic depression with psilocybin, which when I first proposed and was studying about this, I was really latched into this materialistic, neurocentric paradigm for analyzing the information and coming up with my ideas. I was reading research papers on brain health and neuroplasticity and all this stuff. And then by the time it came to the point wherein I was about to actually prepare the presentation, I had completely let go of this very idea that I needed to explain it with neuroscience for it to be legit, and realized that the very essence of what I was trying to explain filtered entirely through subjectivity. And so then I just gave a presentation basically saying that subjectivity is like the key element of all experience and all illness, especially depression. But I didn't get to finish the presentation because the power went out.
Oh, no.
Yeah, because it was during that big storm, or what was supposed to be a really big storm on the island, and then it was a big storm for some places and not for others. So the last 30%, which I was about to drop this bomb, I could explain it maybe, but I was about to basically say the treatment of psilocybin or chronic depression with psilocybin is via the placebo effect, which I was hoping, you know, like get roars and all sorts of things and have a really great clickbaity title to share the talk later. But I didn't even get to do that. Oh. It's just a totally regular talk with no controversy at all.
Well, would you ever consider going online and maybe kind of finishing that and just having at least for your community to...
Oh, yeah. It's totally on the list when I get back. Right now, I'm at basically 8 months of moving around, and I'm just struggling to keep maintenance up on the world of my life,
right.
My online life. So podcasts now, the At Mind Radio is like once a month.
Right.
So, but I do have intention to do that. Cool. It's... Yeah, I have a list of things that I'm, like I was saying to you guys beforehand, that they're all, like the pins are all out, and I'm just going to land back in the office and set them up so I can knock them down.
Nice. The beautiful thing about the podcast, though, you can kind of do that from anywhere, really. Mm-hmm. You can bring a little recorder with you wherever you are. Unless you want to have your full like studio set up, you can kind of do a podcast anywhere.
Yeah, I did actually do a lot of on-location recordings with some people that I just spontaneously stumbled into while I was traveling through Europe and Australia. That was like, wow, these people are incredible. And here I am sitting with them in their space or somewhere, like, let's get this interview. But that doesn't come with the video, and that video aspect I really like. And
yeah.
I travel with a little MacBook Air, and so it's like, oh, I'm going to render video now, so I don't have this computer for 20 hours.
Right.
I need to make sure it's in a safe place to be open and plugged in and not messed with or in a insecure location.
Yeah, it's not as efficient when you're on the road, obviously, right?
Yeah.
And so, yeah, take us to what were you, your past year, it's been about a year since you've been on the show, really, I guess. Some of the things you've done, highlights of this year, where you've gone, and you were sharing some really interesting stories with me online that we can kind of dive into a little bit, the Australawaska story.
Yeah,
I got to the point, I was reading it, and I got to the point, I got interrupted, unfortunately, when you're just about to start going camping with these gentlemen to have that experience, and is building up. So I'm excited to actually get the live version if it can be shared.
Yeah, it was interesting when you're like, what are you working on now? Like, oh, here are some things. Please, God, don't share them. They're draft. They're terribly written. But the first draft of everything is shit.
Right. As a more experienced author of yourself, I can, but that's super true. Like, But in terms of this past year, like, yeah, what have, you know, what's come across your plate?
Well,
what have you been exploring? What's been interesting you the last little while?
Well, the biggest thing that's been interesting to me is trauma, and in particular, sorting through trauma and coming to understand what effect it's having in my life, because I had cultivated, mind you, I didn't go see a physician to get the official diagnosis, but I met all the appropriate categories for post-traumatic stress disorder, that the critical event that led me to that place was actually an experience I had at an ayahuasca retreat in Peru where I nearly died. I somewhat comically now call it the pineapple incident. It's a long story that would be a long full-on story that would require a lot of presence for me to tell that I'm not fully into in this moment, to be honest. But it had a dramatic effect on me when I returned to an environment that also had a lot of other stuff to sort through. So ultimately, this really big, painful, and scary experience got sort of buried. And in being buried, a core aspect of myself became disconnected from who I am, and the adaptations around that started, plus all the other things happening in my life that were kind of toxic and challenging, sort of fed into this system that eventually became post-traumatic stress disorder and an anxiety condition where I was having heart palpitations and even had to end up going to see a cardiologist to make sure I didn't damage my heart. All the while I was like, oh, I just need to take more psychedelics and that'll fix it. But it just kept getting more intense. And the only one I didn't do again was ayahuasca because I was afraid of it. Mind you, the night after I died, I went into for four more ceremonies deeper into the jungle at a different retreat where I didn't know anyone, and the shaman was hands off, to say the least.
Right.
Like, barely there, in my opinion. But I was obviously biased. I was in a suffering place. I mean, so that's what I've been going through. That's what I've been interested in.
Sounds like a lot.
Yeah.
And that's, I think you bring up a really interesting kind of topic there, actually, is, you know, going into these experiences and being, I don't know. I don't know if you can ever say being prepared for it, because it is like one of those things where you can only kind of prepare so much consciously and the rest is kind of up to the experience. However, even still, like, you know, being really careful with these things in general, you know, like psychedelics, ayahuasca, spirit plant medicines, you know, they're really serious things, and they're amazing in a lot of ways when used with a lot of health and respect and reverence. But it's not something to be just, you know, casually necessarily doing, because, you know, it can be really intense and it runs really deep. I don't think the depth of what it is fully understood yet, at least not by Western science, in terms of like what's happening on like the psycho-spiritual level of it all. You know what I mean?
In that experience, were you with people that maybe weren't the best facilitators of that experience?
Well, the answer to that is kind of slippery. So I totally agree with everything that you were saying. In fact, every choice that I made around the psychedelics that I was using at that time, I mean, I write books on reverence and building mature context and this kind of thing. The night that I had this incident, it wasn't necessarily a failure on behalf of the facilitation in regards to, oh, they didn't hold the space right or something. It was kind of a freak accident in a way that I made a choice that I should have known better, but also maybe I should have been held in a space where I wasn't encouraged to do something. And not that I was encouraged, that I wasn't necessarily given the option to do something. And then I made the mistake of, instead of staying with this group and taking a break after this extremely terrifying experience, to instead get dropped off halfway back to Iquitos and hike into the jungle to go deeper. Like, that was my choice. So it wasn't necessarily that the circle wasn't holding me well in the sense of creating an ayahuasca experience, then it was totally fine. But in a sense of being a space that could really hold deep, powerful, traumatic, potentially traumatic experiences or emergence of traumatic material outside of the cosmological context of the jungle, I don't think that they were fully there. I don't think most places are there. This whole weekend retreat ayahuasca thing, your circle that you drink with, and you just go and you drink a couple times and then you leave over the weekend and you talk plant spirits and you talk cosmology. And that works for a while, but if you're dealing with something really, really intense and super traumatic and recent in your life, then having that totally broken open and having someone sing songs to you isn't necessarily going to help you when you get back. It might be a really powerful process in the moment, but what do you do with that? I'm not against ayahuasca. I'm not against the facilitators, et cetera, or the circles that are going around necessarily, though I have high levels of distrust for the general culture around it. But it's what you do when you come back. So the circles weren't necessarily out of integrity. They were actually fairly good circles to be drinking in, but they weren't prepared to handle the intensity of what came up for me. I wasn't prepared to handle it. And when I came back, no one else was prepared to handle it because nobody really had the model that in my life, the models needed to hold me in it. And furthermore, I was going back to live with my parents. My sister had a baby. I wanted to go be a part of my little nephew's life. And they weren't really savvy to any of this stuff either. So it wasn't so much the context of the circle that made it problematic, but it was the context of the circle that made it problematic when it emerged and I wasn't able to be held long-term or short-term in the experience.
Right. Yeah. When I was down in at Spirit Quest, that's one thing Don Howard really, he emphasized a lot that they actually have less potent brews, simply because he said that if you have an experience maybe like that one, it can be so intimidating that people might not ever come back, and they actually could cause more harm than good. Mm-hmm. And well, that's one thing I really liked about Spirit Quest, was just that they're really conservative and cautious with the group that's there. And like, some people were complaining because they were like, oh, it's not strong enough or something. But I don't think I'd want to have that experience necessarily, you know? I mean, maybe there's some value in it for you, but I feel like that would be a pretty intimidating thing to go through.
Yeah, it definitely is. And again, I want to like reinforce that I don't think that the context in which this incident happened, that they weren't there holding me. Like, everyone came to help me, but nobody really knew how to help me. Mm. And
that kind of leads me into like, you know, this current time that we're in, this day and age of you know, this civilization, this global emerging civilization, now that we're all more interconnected now virtually, combined with the discovery and this psychedelic renaissance, as has been said many times within the context of science and research and within pop culture even, and like and culture, you know, let's say like 500 years from now, historians are looking back on this time. How do you see, in terms of the context of this, these entheogens, the psychedelia that's coming into this culture at this moment, how do you think it is right now? Is it a relatively kind of archaic, chaotic time? Like, we don't really know what we're doing. We don't really have the infrastructure in place. Like, what are your kind of thoughts around this time period in context with these sorts of conversations that we're having and this kind of medicine work, if you will?
Well, you kind of described what I would say is that when we look back, I'd say that we will see this time as a really important time in our reestablishment of non-ordinary states of consciousness, psychedelics being a part of that, into our general social discourse and lifestyle. Yeah. But right now it's haphazard. Right. What's happening with the academia, their movements, is like very regimented to make sure that nothing goes wrong, like things sort of went wrong in the 70s when it got super popular, sort of escaped the laboratory and was causing all these people to wake up to the injustices of society and demand a better world, which was not advantageous to the power structures that be. Mm-hmm. So being really careful to maintain a medicalization paradigm around it. And I think that'll go over successfully. And as much as I'm not really for the lock and key medicalization of psychedelics, I also see that there's really no other way than it's going to come into civilized society except through the way of the universities and that kind of research.
Mm-hmm. Are you referring mostly to what MAPS is doing right now?
Yeah, MAPS and other organizations for sure.
What other organizations are doing work like that?
The Hefner organization as well, which is Dennis McKenna and Amanda Fielding, and I'm not sure who else, but there are people that are unaffiliated with MAPS whose main goal, as far as I can tell, is specifically right now with MDMA and then consolidating and helping to fund and promote psychedelic research that's happening in other places around the world.
Gotcha.
Yeah. But I believe there's a couple other organizations that are coming up right now that I've had emails coming from, but I can't really place the names right now.
Yeah. I think the MAPS model is a really intelligent one. And I think, you know, like you were alluding to in the 70s when, you know, the government decided to crack down and the whole war on drugs got launched in response to what was going on there. You know, when I've attended MAPS conferences in the past, they did really want to maybe de-emphasize like recreational use and really just focus on that medical model, mm-hmm. which I think is probably the most intelligent way to do it, just so we don't have a whole another crackdown. And with the current you know, president of the United States or soon to be president of the United States. I don't know if like,
if it finds out that it's economically feasible and it will economically benefit the country, chances are he'll do it. It's like, oh, that could make us some money.
Well, yeah, do it. If that happens, yeah. But I feel like they're just so conservative that they were just like shut it down, you know, and really go, you know, back into the hard prohibition. Mm. And then we'd kind of be thrown back into what we've been used to, really.
I don't know if they will do that, because the thing is like, how much more prohibited can they get at this point? It's about as prohibited as those I almost said medicines. I'm so sort of like apprehensive about using that term, but it's already pretty lock and key for all the ones that they want to do the research on. And then the ones that they don't have that aren't lock and key are constantly going into lock and key, like steadily. So like the research chemicals and stuff, like slowly getting scheduled as soon as it becomes a problem. Mm. Yeah. But if you look at what happened recently with Kratom, where Kratom had this fast pace, like, oh, we're making it Schedule 1 right now that the DEA did this. And I read somewhere, I didn't read up on this particular sentence as much as I could have because I've been traveling, but there was a comment being made about all the things that people were claiming Kratom can do for coming down off of opiates. And they had mentioned that it was similar to this new drug that's in design through the pharmaceutical company. And then they like moved on. I'm like, oh, that's why Kratom's getting illegal, because they're about to replace it with a pharmaceutical. But anyways, the interesting part about this story is that the FDA turned that back from after basically civilian lobbying against them, which has never happened before. Even MAPS, I believe they are able to work with MDMA now, and I hope that the internet world can correct me if this is wrong. They're able to work with MDMA now because one of the things that helped them get there was that they had petitioned the DEA to remove it from Schedule 1 with the help of a bunch of doctors and stuff. They placed charges against the DEA for improper scheduling because the DEA was supposed to make it Schedule 3 or Schedule 2 or something. Hmm. But they were like, nope. Wait, can I swear on your show?
Yes, oh, yeah. Please.
They were like, nope, fuck it, Schedule 1. We don't want it. You know, so yeah, I don't think it's gonna go back. The question is whether or not it's gonna make a mess in the process, if we're gonna make too much of a mess in the process. And I think that MAPS is doing a pretty good job to be safe about it. But I personally, maybe this is my own authority issues from growing up in a Christian household, but I personally feel a little weird about giving the permission to use psychedelics to a governing body. Well, at the same time, I feel good about people who don't know much and are using it quite irresponsibly. I'm not making comments on recreational use. I mean like really irresponsible, dangerous use of these things, hurting themselves accidentally and having that be prevented in some way through proper education and institutionalizing education around it and this kind of stuff. But I'm a real fence sitter on that stuff. Like, okay, go MAPS, sweet. And then underground, you guys keep doing your thing too, right? Because
I think it takes both. I think both have a role to play, or else they wouldn't be playing. But I think too, from just my personal experience, this is my kind of opinion on it, that even through the medicalization model, the experiences that can occur regardless are so paradigm shifting potentially that, you know, the openness to bring it out of just the medicalization and into more of a mainstream, you know, generalized use a little more openly and freely kind of goes with that paradigm shift, you know? Mm-hmm. So I could see it's going to, you know, people will just be like, yeah, they'll not only can they experience potentially the healing that they're after, but they'll just have a better relationship of themselves with the universe in general and their place in it and how things fit together and how we should treat each other well and support each other and take care of each other and so forth. And then I think that sort of paradigm shift can can change those things that I think you're getting at a little bit too.
Well,
I can see that happen.
Rick talking about, I think it was on maybe Duncan Trussell's podcast, like his overall big vision for maps. And that was how, if they can prove that MDMA is actually useful, if he feels like it could open up the gateway to changing people's minds, mm-hmm. that these substances aren't all bad. Right, because if one's actually being useful for medical purposes and they're showing benefit to it, well, then maybe the next one they do is psilocybin and they show some benefits to that one, and it just it changes the public perception around the whole thing as opposed to what it currently is, and that drugs are bad for the most part. I don't know. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think that's from what I see their perspective too. Like one of the things that I saw in a talk from Rick Doblin recently was legalization follows medicalization. And once you bring these things into like, oh, you know, it's normal. It's probably fine. You know, that's how amphetamines got into the diet of housewives in the 50s or whatever, right? And it's like, oh, amphetamine, it's fine. That's why something equivalent to meth is being given out to kids with Adderall. It's like, oh, it's like through the doctors, it's fine. It doesn't have stigma. And then so we could reverse those stigma by medicalizing the psychedelics, which would then make the experiences, the characteristics of those experiences accessible for common discourse. If there's no stigma around me saying, oh, I took mushrooms, then if I roll up at the office on Monday afternoon and they're like, how was your weekend? And you're like, oh, I actually had a psilocybin session with my therapist this weekend. And they're like, oh, wow, cool. I don't have mine for 6 months. I'm so excited. What'd you experience? Well, I experienced oneness with the universe, actually. I felt like I reconnected with my dead parent and like they love me. And I don't know if that was real, but I just feel so complete in my grieving process. And I just feel really genuinely happy, like everything's going to be okay. Instead of, oh, I watched Netflix.
Yeah.
Basically just watched Netflix. We had a couple drinks.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that changes the whole discourse of how we show up. It changes the general narrative for a person's lives because we are the, you know, what is it? We're the average of the five people we spend the most time with, which has to do with, you know, somatic posturing and body language, but then general thought patterns, linguistic patterns, and what you're talking about. And so if that's the kind of stuff that you're talking about, because that's totally normal to talk about, then like you were mentioning, what kind of world do we live in if all of a sudden a sense of connection and goodness and compassion is what is the underlying theme in our common discourse.
Yeah. And it changes everything. Right. And that's part of my just personal motivation behind all this. And I'm sure yours as well is like supporting these types of, you know, like you are one of, you know, you're an author on psychedelia and also in a very unique kind of generational bracket for yourself. You're still pretty young. Mm-hmm. You are very young. And it's really cool. Like I have tremendous respect for you and what you're doing.
Thank
and how
you.
You're not kind of following a model of any type. You're kind of just figuring it out as you go. And I'm sure it has its struggles and stuff, but I really appreciate that you're just following your path and doing it the way you're doing it. And it's going to be cool to see if like this type of world, this paradigm that we're kind of chatting about here plays out, what your career will kind of blossom into. I'm sure you can't, why even bother trying to guess what that's going to be like? Because that world is going to be a different world.
Mm-hmm.
And I do believe it's going to happen. Like it's happening. You know, it is happening. And that's why we are in this very weird kind of limbo state. And how long is that going to last for? We don't know. But I'm just glad to be involved, you know, and I think it's really cool.
Yeah. It's interesting to say it's happening because in certain demographics, in certain cultures, it does feel like it's happening, right? But then there's a whole bunch of other stuff that's getting exposed in the process. And to sort of use the psychedelic experience as some sort of like larger metaphor, in order to push through into that those positive feelings, oftentimes you have to face the darkness that you've been hiding from in order to see it and own it and live it and be it and then see what exists when you're no longer wasting a bunch of energy holding it down. A lot of that stuff is coming up right now, like sexism, racism, white privilege, colonialism, massive wars, and like the issue with authoritarianism in the United States, the rise of Donald Trump. Then you've got things that are distracting people like crazy, like flat earth theory and the Mandela effect. And there's like, and then what's happening with Standing Rock and what's basically terrorism against people, right? By way of the police and the military being paid off by the economics, like the larger economic system that wants this pipeline to go through. At least that's as far as I know it to be. I don't even know what's true on Facebook anymore because it's all like sensationalized journalism or anti-media. And it's like, so it's this place of total confusion and chaos. And yeah, so it's interesting that we're talking about things are going good, but on the surface, it seems like we're in the most wild, crazy, disorganized, fucked up global narrative we've ever been in.
Totally. It's so strange.
And that's, I think that's what has to happen. Like you said, like the darkness will present itself. The shadows have to be seen. And we've had some gargantuan shadows in North America the last 400 years or whatever that need to be looked at honestly. Mm-hmm. And you know, like,
but, yeah, but you're seeing like in with the whole, like you said, you touched on the whole Trump presidential campaign, you're seeing maybe you call it the shadow side of the North American culture coming out in a lot of different ways. And he just basically honed in on that, tapped into something that maybe they knew was still there. And he rode that wave, and now he's president because of
that. this whole curiosity. It's like, oh, you know, Hillary should have won if all the millennials voted, or if the popular vote, and blah blah blah. It's like, if Hillary won, it would be the same old devil that we've always known, totally, and all this like racism and like basically all this racism and sexism and horrible shit that's happening in the United States would be continue to be under the lid, and those people would continue to stew in it and get more and more hateful and disenfranchised, and it would only just emerge out of the next one. Mm-hmm. All the while we would continue to drop bombs on children, you know, brown people in another country is what the United States is basically doing. It's like, oh yeah, well, it's not the U.S. We got to protect the U.S.
Yeah,
or whatever, the U.S. investments. So, I mean, Hillary's was going to do that. It's just confusing to me why people were so surprised and shocked, because it's like, why are you shocked at all? As soon as you saw that the Democratic National Committee or whatever was basically manipulating the vote to make sure that Bernie Sanders didn't become the candidate for the Democratic Party, you already knew you couldn't trust this. And then all these other things coming out with the Podesta emails and WikiLeaks and links to Russia. And it's like, why would you be surprised that Trump won? Why aren't you just surprised or just like completely giving in to recognizing that the entire system's been rigged for years and years? It's the only reason it got this far. Yeah, they're rigged and messed up.
Totally. It's so hard, like you touched on as well. Who do you listen to? Who do you trust? You know, what sources can you trust these days?
Me? I don't know. I'm like checking in. For the most part, I'm trying not to make any like definitive claims because I don't know. The sources that I'm listening to right now is my inner voice as I'm paying attention to as much dialogue as possible. Like on my Facebook page, I have a tendency to post things that are kind of like triggering and then just watch what happens. Excuse me, and pay attention to the community, because I think the best way for me to learn right now is to shut up and listen. Not that I'm not on this show to talk, but like online is just to shut up and listen. The people that I trust the most are usually the ones that slant towards the bias that I'm comfortable with. So even then, I don't know if I can trust them. So Democracy Now, I like that slant. I like what Amy Goodman, I trust that news source.
Yeah.
And then I really like Vice, but I know that they're biased, and I know that they're biased and the same bias that I have. So that's positive too. So I don't know, even this whole Standing Rock thing, some people are, you know, you got the narrative that we probably identify with, which is the water protectors versus the evil corporation, right? And it's horrible. The militarized police and the way that these people are treated is absolutely abysmal. And then you've got this other narrative that's like, you know, they're not representing what they claim to be representing and blah, 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 which is maybe just BS being fed into the discourse to try to distract people, you know, like people that are like, well, the Alberta oil sands are actually much more environmentally friendly than they used to be. It's really the best way. Fracking is really the best way to extract natural gas. We need to use fossil fuels to move to sustainability. Paraphrase, right? Justin Trudeau. Mm. You know, we have all these discussions. I don't know what's true anymore. I'm just like sitting back and kind of watching what happens.
You know, though, I think you can look at that situation and I think you can take the idea that we know we cannot continue doing fossil fuels forever, and they're building infrastructure to support fossil fuels. So the arguments that are supporting that side of the pipeline are most likely the ones that are incorrect. Most
probably, yeah. And then the question is about financial gain too. So if what side of the argument has the most to gain financially at what cost to the rest of us? And usually you would side towards, as me being in the same class as you guys, which is not the elite class, I would sign against Goliath.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But I don't really know what's happening there. I'm not there. And I get really frustrated with people who present themselves like they know 100% what's going on. I get that people get impassioned, and it's a good reason to get impassioned, but it's like, we don't know what's happening there. Until you're there, you don't know.
Right.
If somebody came back and they were like, I was at Standing Rock, this is what's happening, or we see the videos, that seems pretty obvious. Mm-hmm. But it's like, until somebody can come in and be like, yeah, I've been on both sides, I know everything that's happening, here's the detail, and I already trust that person, yeah, then I have no idea.
Plus, going back to, like, say, when it actually started, too. You know, going there now as like a supporter, seeing this, like, you know, this conflict happening. Okay, but what, you know, what was it like 6 months, 10 months, a year ago, you know, while this was like kind of building up? And what were the initial, how did that whole process proceed? Was it actually done on site, or was it like people going in courtrooms and being like, you know, what was that whole process? What's the whole story?
Yeah, are you like looking for the oily rag? The house is burning down. You know, the house is burnt down at this point. It's like pretty terrible out there. You're looking for the oily lamp. Like, what caused the fire?
Right.
Despite not having any idea and being completely agnostic and hands off with that whole thing, I do think it's very interesting that what we are looking at is this big example of how mainstream media manipulates and hides information in the way that is most advantageous to their gain.
Mm-hmm.
And that what's happening in Standing Rock is a good example of that. And it's also a huge example of the people versus power, versus the established power, like David and Goliath. And I said I was raised Christian, so the metaphor, like the myth, is clear to me. And I find that really interesting, and seeing how that'll play out on a global scale. Well, yeah, I guess we'll see what happens.
Totally. But I agree, though. I think it's a really interesting kind of, wow, this fall has been super interesting because of that and the election, and seeing all these like very like mythic kind of things play out in live in front of us right now, like, well, you know, over the internet. Yeah, but, yeah. You know, and seeing like major issues of the colonization, indigenous rights, the environmentalism, you know, in my mind, those are the two big things that, yeah, are at the forefront and that need to be represented here, and that's why I am, you know, supporting the water protectors in that, because I believe in those rights. I'm like, yeah, our environment is messed up, or at least we're not in a harmonious state with it. So okay, let's see our leaders take this, you know, take some sort of stance, you know. Mm-hmm. If it's possible. But I mean, I'm sure they're in like there's a lot of judicial stuff going on, that with contracts written and stuff, but you know, at what point does like someone just really like, you know, take a very bold stance somehow, somewhere? I don't know how that even is possible, but you know, it cannot be done.
And we talked about this a little bit before, and I think it comes down to the individual and the individual's choices and what we make on a day-to-day basis. I feel like that's so important, you know, just the idea of voting with your dollars, and like living the life that you know you think people should live, right? Mm-hmm. Are you being as a good steward to the planet? Are you, or am I, you know, living as sustainably as I can right now, right? Because I mean, if we're gonna wait for government to regulate something in to protect the environment, maybe, like, I mean, Germany did it. Germany did it like a little while ago. I think they said by 2030, they're going to have all fossil fuel vehicles off the roads in Germany.
Wow, that's big. Yeah.
So, that, I mean, that's one example of a government stepping in and saying, okay, enough is enough. We're going to do that, right? But I don't know. I don't know if North America is going to do that. And I just feel
Germany isn't bought and sold like North America is bought and sold to larger corporate bodies.
So I'm just thinking, like, for me right now, it's like, what can I do today to actually make some kind of a difference? And it's like the choices that I make on a day-to-day basis, really.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, that's the frustrating part for me is like the change can happen so much quicker if the leaders with the so-called power actually, you know, stand up and make, you know, a proactive, sustainable decision like the Scandinavian countries do or like Germany has. You know, they're, you know, they're in a different situation for sure, but you can make change a lot faster when it's kind of mandated in that way versus like the people, the little cells accumulating together to coagulate against the flow of oil or whatever.
I heard it said on another podcast. It was really good. He's like, as soon as you change the will of the people, the governments will fall in line. So mm-hmm. the governments, you know, their goal is to get reelected pretty much every 4 years or whatever. So as soon as you change what the people really want, the governments will fall in line very quickly based on, you know, the demand because they're going to do what they need to do to please people to get reelected. So if you change the population's perspectives, the government will just follow suit because they want to continue being in power.
Within reason, I mean, once you're in power, you have that power. Like Justin Trudeau had all sorts of things that he said he was going to do. And mind you, he's only been in for a year. So, I mean, benefit of a doubt. But he backed out on the election reform. He backed out on that.
That bugged me.
Yeah, and he was talking about sustainable green technologies, and now he's investing in pipelines and approving this kind of stuff. I saw, I saved an article on my way here because I couldn't read it because I was walking in the door basically, and it was like, fake left, step right. So I'm really curious about what's going to happen. I hate being proven right in my mind because I had the sense that he was just going to turn into Obama and look really lefty, but then do a bunch of stuff that's basically the same direction that it's always been. So, but
yeah, it felt like that for me during this campaign, actually. I felt like I saw this. There's one video in particular where literally it was him in one of the parliament buildings in Ottawa. And I'm like, I was watching this video. I'm like, this seems really fake. This seems very scripted, very like the way he was speaking, the context of the question and the answer. Mm-hmm. I'm like, this doesn't feel real at all. And ever since then, I had a very kind of like, skeptical feeling towards Trudeau. I did vote for him, you know.
But why did you vote for him? Did you vote for him because you supported him, or did you vote for him because he represented what the people wanted, which was no more Stephen Harper?
Yeah, probably. I didn't want Stephen Harper.
That's the reason I voted for him, because I didn't want Stephen Harper.
Right.
And I did it like gritting my teeth in some way, like, I'm voting strategically.
Yeah.
It didn't even matter. I was voting in Alberta.
But you're right. Writing. And then another thing that I'd like to share, because I saw this was like, you know, with that whole, he was going to make voting reform, mm-hmm. change how the votes actually happen in Canada. Because one example of that is if, you know, under this new voting reform that is you know, where the actual votes are way more applied to the actual parties people vote for. The best example is the Green Party has one seat right now in the House of Commons, I guess.
Yeah.
Whereas if they actually got the equivalent of what their votes were, they would have had 10 seats, which is way more voting power within the House of Commons, you know? Mm-hmm. So the voting reform, which should happen, will be much more representative of what people actually want. And that, you know, he backed out of it.
Right. Pretty sure there was a forum open for citizens of Canada to give their perspectives on voting reform. And I saw it. And by the time I saw it, it was already done. It was like a 30-day forum. There was no media around it at all. And I've been kind of watching it, and I didn't see anything. And by the time I clicked to go like, yeah, all right, I'll give my perspective. Oh, it's already closed. And then he said that it seemed like Canadians didn't really care anymore. And it's like, well, maybe you shouldn't have buried the forum deep in the site and only given 30 days. You have any idea how distracted people are with their Facebook and their TV shows and Netflix? You need to give them time to find out that there's something official happening.
Yeah. It seems like they pass a lot of, especially in the States, they pass a lot of bills like at the 11th hour late at night when there's some other big distraction going on.
Yep.
Which is really interesting.
That distraction being serendipitous or intentional.
Yeah. So, okay. So the system's broken. We got that. wait,
before moving on, I just want to say that as much as I'm kind of confused, given the context, I stand with Standing Rock. Just putting it out there.
Nice. Yeah. So where do we go from here? You know, if we could let our imaginations run a little wild right now and be like, you know, if James could, you know, wave a wand and change something that he wanted to change in the world right now, what would you do?
God, it's like, all right, this is it, James. This is the moment.
Don't worry, it'll come.
Okay, so I'll think about what has been really meaningful for me, like essentially meaningful in a recent process around this post-traumatic stress disorder that I mentioned, that I felt really resolved, was that, so what I would hope or I could give to the world would be every single person on the planet have the experience and the knowledge, like the direct visceral knowing that they have somebody that can hold them and listen, where they can be vulnerable and they can feel safe and heard and supported and honored. That's probably what I would like to, if I could add one thing.
Why?
Because I feel like it, for me, what happened was all of a sudden I could really look at what I wasn't looking at, and I was trying to hold on too strong in myself. Like I was strong. I was going to sort it out. I was going to fix everything. And then all of a sudden, when I was in a place where I could actually trust that I was being heard and seen and listened to and let go, then I really was able to learn about who I was and what was happening. And I could really process some dark, heavy stuff that was inside of me. And when I think about the times that I'm most struggling, and when I'm most struggling is the time that I most likely do an impulsive action. Now, mind you, I'm not the kind of person that would assault a person on the street. I'm not the kind of person that would rob another person. I'm not doing this kind of extreme crime or violent crime or whatever. But it's the times when I'm most desperate and feel most alone and most like caught up that I do things that later I realize like that was a wrong choice. That was a bad choice that I made. That was a mistake.
Like for me eating half a cheese pizza and being like, shit.
Well, that's
I'm gonna regret that one.
In a way, yes, but it's more like when I spoke to this person in this way, or I had this perception of a context or another person's behavior or a situation that led me to respond to it in a way that created more harm than good. And maybe this is idealistic and optimistic to think that if people had this, like a therapist, for example, like a good therapist, that if people felt like they were truly being held, even physically, by someone who deeply cared for them, then it would start to address a foundational wound that we all have, or most of us have, which is the sense of being separated from being truly cared for by our parents or by some sort of larger mystical source, if you want to go into that. But if that was sort of supported, I really think that there would be less, it would start to kind of heal out the fringe issues that go on. I think
Do you think that's something that has happened to our society, say like over the last couple hundred years, or do you think this is something just the human experience of like feeling separate or isolated? Or do you think it's like when we maybe came out of like tribalism and that, you know, lost that kind of really small, tight group community, family bond? Like, where do you think, or how do you think like that, you know, I don't know, what do you think caused that sort of potential?
Maybe that disconnect?
Disconnection, yeah.
Well, I love that you guys are asking me these huge questions that I don't even think I'm like,
no, we're just talking. For.
So I'm thinking about
this. I like your mind. So it's like, you know, dig into it.
I would think that some of the stuff that I was looking into, that it would start around the time that we began to separate out of small band, hunter-gatherer type things, and started alienating ourselves into smaller family groups through agriculture and husbandry, and then eventually into increasingly smaller groups as we were increasingly more isolated from the land and put into cities, and then the nuclear family, and then plus all the violence in much of our history and the inability and incapacity to recognize what trauma and violence, what violence and trauma will do to a person and how that can carry over intergenerationally. Mm. And then a bunch of really bad parenting advice coming out of narratives and paradigms that were, like, I think, based in really ignorant thinking, such as just let the baby cry it out, for example. put it in a bed as soon as possible, like in its own little bed, its own little room as soon as possible. This kind of stuff that creates this deep separation anxieties. And then the like hospital-based birthing. I'm not totally against all these things, but if we're looking at it problematically, hospital-based birthing, everything's an emergency and like the woman is like lying down basically, or the female's lying down rather than like kind of in a squatting type position. And yeah, there's like forceps being used and incubators. There's all sorts of things. And mind you, a lot of lives are saved because of these practices too. But there's a lot to look at. I think it kind of goes back to our fundamental disconnect from each other and from nature.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I definitely agree with that.
Me too. That was really good.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah, I like that. I like being able to go back. Like, I don't know, it's cool to be able to have a conversation where people can like kind of zoom out and bring all these different kind of factors in and try to bring them in into like a congealed way. It's fun.
You know, I feel like, you know, all the realms that we kind of play in, right? You can talk about psychedelic realms, the meditational realms, whatever you want to call it, consciousness expanding. I feel like that's all part of the solution, part of the answer. What do you think about that?
I think there's a lot of things that are happening right now that are part of the answer. And by, I don't know, a part of understanding the problem. I don't know what it means to have an answer. But again, I'm getting increasingly more of an agnostic fence sitter on almost everything. But I don't know if there's an answer. So I think psychedelics altered states is big because it gets us out of our mind. Like even our drugs of choice as a society, cigarettes, alcohol, coffee. Coffee reinforces where we're at. Cigarettes reinforce where we're at. Alcohol just shuts us off from everything, right? And so either way, we're being reinforced in where we're at, where other things like breath practices, serious meditation, serious yoga, serious entheogen practice, even recreational entheogen practice takes us out of our normal sense of self. And it's like we get an opportunity to triangulate who we are a little bit more complexly. And then we can think about things differently rather than in the deeply ingrained and established paradigms that we have based on our childhood conditioning, educational indoctrination, and even multiple generations of belief perceptions that are passed on, yeah. As far as I could imagine, epigenetically.
Yeah, it's so interesting. I think about this a lot. Like, why does one person kind of stay the course along the normal North American standard narrative? And then why does one person deviate off of that? You know, if you look at our own lives, my life is, you know, we were raised very traditionally. You know, we played normal North American sports. We had normal North American education. We had all of that normal upbringing. But for whatever reason, we've deviated and we've gone this in total, complete different way now. And I'm always wondering, why do some people do that and others just keep going, you know?
I imagine it would just be a question of personality and how personality is reinforced by childhood conditioning and experience, like the X factor, random luck and chance as well.
Yeah.
And I don't feel capable or familiar enough to be able to explain all the potential variables around that. But I would imagine it's just on like kind of who you showed up as based on where you're coming from and the experience you have that builds you into the person that you are, which is some strange combination of who you are authentically and who you are as a series of compensational strategies for the challenges and struggles in your life that you never fully dealt with.
Yeah. You know, like we were raised in a sense, like we weren't raised religious, you know? And I think that probably helped a little bit. And also I think we had an early, travel experience where we went to Australia, we went to the South Pacific and we saw different countries and different cultures outside of our own. Mm-hmm. I feel like those type of experiences can definitely shift somebody in a little different direction and broaden your horizons.
Yeah, it seems like you had an experience when you're quite young, when you're establishing your sense of identity, that there is great adventure and mm-hmm. gain to be had in going outside of your familiar space in a safe way, because you went with family, I imagine.
Yeah.
So you're with your safety.
Parents. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, for me, I think one of the things was it's in my family history to leave. My father and my mother left where they were living in rural Newfoundland because my father felt like he wanted to build build a better life for us and move us to Ontario and out of like rural Newfoundland's family dynamics that they didn't perceive to be healthy and get us into a different place. My father followed the work So we moved around a lot. So when I was a kid, I was moving around all the time doing stuff. And I have in the story this like going west to find the work, to find your path, which is something that my father did as well. I didn't even realize that was a part of his story till I had already been doing it, which is a interesting thing.
So. Now you touched on this a little bit earlier and you said, well, you're kind of haphazardly putting together this, this is a bad way of saying it, but image or branded image online, and you got your podcast, and you have all the pins in scattered places. You want to put them all together. Mm-hmm. What do you think your path is?
Yeah, I've been reflecting on this. So if you were to ask me this question in 2012, I would probably tell you like late 2011. Wait, let's go back further. So if you were to ask me in 2010, I would have said, I don't know. My path is to eat mushrooms once a month and try to figure out what the hell's going on. And then in late 2011, I might tell you that my path, like what I'm doing is to awaken, like to be a writer. Yeah. And then 2012, it was to awaken consciousness, like wake up the world. And then in 2013, it was to upgrade all of human consciousness around their relationship to psychedelics, like bridging science and underground culture and speaking in an accessible dialect that still meets the discourse levels of the highly experienced and the first timers. And now if you ask me it, I had this revelation recently, which is that I just want to build a sphere where I guess I can offer what I mentioned I felt like everyone should have, like this sense of being held, sense of being seen. But I want to offer it in the sense of sharing who I am and sharing my humanity through writing, through story, and sharing the different models, frameworks, language maps that have helped me come to a better sense of ease in who I am and a better sense of understanding of what it means to face my challenges as being human. So what I want to do now, I guess, is create an environment where it just feels like I share my humanity. I share my humanness and I help humanness be felt more compassionately.
And what would you say you hope to accomplish by doing that?
Ooh, yeah. I don't know yet. Like worldwide, I feel like the amount of audacity I would have to say, I'm going to change the world for the better. You know, what I hope to achieve is just being the absolute best me that I can be in some way here. So you had on your show, Gabor Mate, right? Mm-hmm. Great episode, amazing mind person. This Gabor Mate is, as far as I know from his persona and the one or two times I've had a 5-minute dialogue.
He's phenomenal for sure.
Yeah. So he mentions about this deep sense of being loved conditionally that we learn when we're children, and that he mentions that he even did with his kids. And maybe to some degree you've learned this, I don't know your upbringing, I certainly learned it, which is that I am loved when I do these things. When I do other things, I'm not loved, or that love is used against me as a violent thing. Not that my parents were violent with me, but in the form of anger. Anger at a child, like lash out at a child, is a violent thing for them to experience. You are their primary caregiver. You are the very thing that they identify with as being the essence of their survival on this planet. And to have anger lashed out at them, or to have anger lashed out in their environment, gives them a deep sense. This is my own perspective, so I'm not sure if he said this, but it gives you this deep sense of being unsafe. Yeah, and that's a violent act to propose onto your children. So you are conditionally loved, which means you get older and all of a sudden your value, your adequacy, your worthiness is defined, determined by what you do. And I have this. I like reflect on it often that I need to do this or I need to do that, or I'm not doing this and I'm not doing that. And so because of these things, I am more or less valuable or adequate. And this is something that has positively driven my entire career up to this point. But it has also caused me a lot of issues. So more and more, I'm coming to recognize this deep sense of, and I'm going to paraphrase somebody else who I don't remember, which is that my greatest purpose on this planet is already manifest by simply being manifest. I'm me. I'm here. And so what greater purpose could I have just being myself and sharing that with others and my friends group and my family, and everything after that is like garnish. You know, so what I do with my career, I do because I absolutely love it. I love getting emails from people that my work has positively bettered their lives. I love getting in and getting geeky with people that I think have really amazing minds and trying to tease out what I have found has really positively benefited my sense of self and my life, my happiness, my emotional maturity, all of these things in a way that's accessible for a larger audience to participate in. Like, I love doing that. So I don't know what it is that I'm trying to accomplish. I'm just at this point trying to be me. Yeah. And one of the things that I really love to do is this.
Yeah. I feel like in a sense, your mission is still on the same relative path from everything you're describing. It seems to be a mission of, maybe mission's a bad way to say it, but you seem to be just wanting to heal, wanting to do good in the world, wanting to do better for humanity. That's what it seems like, you know, creating this safe container where people can express themselves. And by you're almost leading by example by doing that yourself. And then maybe that makes it a safe spot for other people to do that. And they can deal with some of their deeper issues. And that's another form of healing. It seems like you're kind of going after the same thing.
Yeah, in a way, I guess. And it just kind of shifts perspective about building a safe place for others. There's this thought in me about moving towards holding, like maybe becoming a trained therapist. Cause I write about all these things, but I'm a writer. I'm not a therapist. I'm not a counselor. I'm not a shaman. I'm not a facilitator other than facilitating public lectures, because I'm not in a place where I'm not going to react and get triggered by things and hold like infinitely safe space. Being a writer, there's this detachment that I can share what it's like for me to do that, and I can discuss those things, and it can be accessible for people.
I think you don't necessarily have to be, you know, a perfect enlightened being to help other people, though. That's the thing, right?
I mean, are any of us?
No, exactly. Well, yeah, about the whole career designation thing or getting that piece of paper. You know, I know a lot of people who make careers out of doing like coaching and things like that, and they don't have any certifications. But people pay them, and they seem to be happy with the results that they get, and it seems to be benefiting their lives positively. You know, I guess what I'm saying is maybe don't get too caught up on like the whole, I need to have this certification in order to help people.
Yeah, I hear you. I'm not really into the need for the certification. My intention about if I wanted to help people in regards to creating the safe space under therapy, that I would want to go through some sort of training and schooling, because I think it's actually quite irresponsible to just be like, oh yeah, well, you know, I kind of did it myself and I took a couple weekend workshops. So yeah, please come to me with your severe like childhood rape trauma and I'll help you pray through it. I think that's actually extremely irresponsible. So if I was going to do that, going to go to that place, I would want to get the highest, most formal education possible, and then add in all whatever like personal tricks or tips that I learned in my own journey after I have that firm foundation in how to help somebody.
Yeah. I understand what you're saying with that. Yeah. And I totally understand and get what you're saying there, because I think it is super, you know, it's a delicate thing. You want to make sure you're holding space for somebody properly. And you're not just going completely into it willy-nilly. So I agree with that too.
But I saw what you were saying. It's different. Like life coaching is a little bit different than helping people resolve trauma.
Well, exactly. I mean, you're not dealing with exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's get you from out of that job and do a better job or something. I don't know.
Yeah. Right? Which.
Yeah. Yeah, transition.
Yeah. That's like somebody that you can trust, somebody that can hold you in their attention, somebody that you can feel safe admitting your challenges with, someone who can encourage you. That's the thing that I think I would like it if we all had. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, some of us just have a lot heavier stuff to work out.
Yeah, and that's I think a huge point kind of there is that the uniqueness of everyone, the uniqueness of the paradoxically similarities between us all, you know, like we all have our own story, but there's so many like, you know, similarities that we can kind of relate to within each other. However, we do have like our uniqueness about it as well. And it is that interesting paradox. And I think that what you're proposing, and yeah, like, you know, with all that you've created online, you work very hard to present what you do and to formulate the books and the podcasts, and like you do excellent work.
Thank you.
And I think it's happening, you know, like, I mean, it's happening in terms of what you're creating. I think, you know, you're like, you were just saying, like it's a similar path, but it's always evolving as you are as well. And it's happening. as you keep going. So I'm really excited to see where you take it, where it takes you. Yeah. You know,
if you want to look at it from like a spiritual, holistic kind of way too, you might just argue that you're doing exactly what you should be doing right now anyways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've gotten to a point where I recognize that a lot of what I'm doing, my career and this public speaking thing, is part of my spiritual practice as well. Cause there's a lot of stuff that comes up when you're about to get in front of an audience.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Or get in front of an eventual audience.
Yeah. It's so revealing.
Yeah.
Oh,
it's
awesome. It's awesome in an awe-ness way. It's like, holy crap. Wow. What do you like look forward to in 2017 at this point in time then?
So in 2017, what I'm looking forward to is like figuratively and literally cleaning my room, I guess.
Nice.
And I'm kind of, again, like haphazardly going through the path. I'm realizing like, oh, I learned a lot of things. I got a lot of skills. I need to go through and check all my magical items and see which ones I need to hold on to and which ones I need to let go of to level up to the next part of my career. And so that's where I'm at in early 2017. It's just getting everything clear and sorted so that I can actually invest deeper into the podcast, because I feel like I can release more content and higher quality content that is more accessible through audio media and visual media that can reach more people in a positive way with podcasting than I can with writing.
100%.
And it also, and not to say that I'm stepping away from writing, because it's like my creative passion and it's what I deeply care about it. But I really want to see that come forth more deeply and really help spread it.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, I think the video format, audio video format, especially for social media these days, is totally the way to go. Like,
yeah.
It's so digestible, right? Anybody can listen to it and watch it, and definitely make a lot of impact that way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Awesome.
Yeah, so that's a plan, and then looking to maybe do another small tour in 2017 if it works out for me.
Yeah.
But trying to slow down that a little bit, because it's really taxing on my life, my body, my mind. I learn a lot, but it's also quite taxing. There's a price to be paid. As exciting and novel as it seems to be off and doing things, which it is, you know, there's a price to be paid. I'm also not settling into strong community. I'm not really building something. I don't have a garden. I don't really know where I belong, because I feel like I belong everywhere, which means I don't really belong anywhere in particular. So there's, and looking to get a little bit more grounded as well. I think I'll produce better work too.
Cool.
Where would you settle if you're going to settle somewhere?
Oh, don't ask me that question. I really love the West Side, but there are some things I need to come into resolution with back in my family environment and my life in Kitchener, which is where I've been sort of based for the last couple of years. And then maybe come out West. I mean, three things happen when I go out there, three possible things. I get there, do my best, still can't make it work for me, and I come out here. Second thing, go there, do my best, I make it work for me, I still decide to come out here. Third thing, I go out there, I do my best, it works for me, I stay. But I don't know what that is yet. So it's like, it's important to have an idea of where I'm headed so that I can more readily, you know, create that auto-hypnotic direction in my subconscious and micro behaviors to lead me into that end goal. But on another level, I really have no idea. So we'll see.
Well, we got 66% chance of seeing James Jesso out in the West Coast.
There you go. Yeah. Well, I just want to, you know, let you have a moment. If there's any final words you want to leave with anybody in general before we start wrapping up here. But is there any kind of, or is there any topic or anything else you wanted to kind of dive into while we were on the show or that we missed, or any final words?
Yeah. So, something for people to Google, yeah, beyond my website, please check me out. If you haven't heard of it yet, Google Cambo, K-A-M-B-O. It's a frog thing that I experienced a few times over this summer that was incredibly powerful and very interesting. And also Ayahuasca, or Acacia brewed ayahuasca, which is something that's emerging out of Australia, which I found very interesting. Which is essentially like a type of ayahuasca brew that's made with Australian plants and is entirely unique and novel to Australia. And it's like an emerging underground spiritual culture reconnecting with the land through a psychedelic brew made with the plants of that land that had never, as far as anyone knows, existed on that land before.
Wow.
Like a neo-Aboriginal movement. So those are two things that I think are interesting for people who tuned in because they saw maybe like some blatantly psychedelic title for this episode that they'll probably find interesting.
Cool.
Yeah.
You're right. It will be blatant. cool. Okay. Well, jameswjesso.com is your website. Links to your books, links to your podcast is all on there. And we'll have it all with this show on iTunes and on YouTube and on the website as well. James, thanks so much for coming back on Vancouver Real, man. Really appreciate it. And we'll see you again, I hope.
Yeah, I hope so too. I don't think that I'd leave the West forever. It's just too good here.
Awesome.
And thank you so much for having me on the show, guys. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for coming in. It was awesome.
Cool. And so floathouse.ca is our website. Use the promo code recovery. Save yourself 20% off a single float. And that's it for me. Anything else?
I had something I want to say, but I forget what it is now. So
Vancouver Real Meetup?
No, because the meetups, this won't get out before
the
meetup.
Yeah, but we're going to have meetups ongoing. So go to the Vancouver Real Facebook group page and you can see when the next meetup is. So we'd love to see you in person if you are around. So come check us out at the Vancouver Real Meetup group page.
All right,
that's cool. Until next time.
To whatever is.
To whatever is.
To whatever is.